Undoing the derivative. So we've been looking at ways to find derivatives and applications of derivatives. Now we're going to look at undoing them. So if we know that the derivative is 2x, what can we say about the original function? Well, you should be thinking immediately that the original function should be x squared, right? That's easy. Derivative of x squared is 2x. But what about the derivative of x squared plus 3? Derivative of x squared is 2x, but the derivative of that constant is 0. So x squared plus 3 would also work. It turns out that any given function has multiple antiderivatives. Here, for example, are a bunch of functions with the derivative of 2x. Similarly, if you knew that the derivative was x squared, you could say that the original function was x cubed over 3. How do you know that? Because if you take x cubed over 3 and you take its derivative, you get 1/3 out front times the derivative of x cubed, which is 1/3 times 3x squared. And of course, those 3 and the 1/3 cancel. But again, you can add a constant, any constant you want to the end, and when you take the derivative of a constant, it's 0. So it should seem like it makes good sense that we know that if g of x is equal to x cubed over 3 plus any constant, then the derivative of g of x is going to be x squared. But that's still going this direction. If we want to go back, how do we know we've got all functions g that will work? How do we know there isn't another function that has the derivative of x squared? Well, this goes back to the mean value theorem. Here's a couple statements to help you remember what we learned from the mean value theorem. First, true or false, if f prime of x is 0 everywhere in an interval, then the function has to be a constant on that interval. This is true. This is a direct result that came from the mean value theorem. The only function that has a derivative of 0 is a constant. Combine this with this next true or false statement. True or false, if two derivatives are equal on an interval, then the functions must be equal on that interval. This one is false. We just said that the derivative of a constant is 0. So if two function derivatives are equal on the interval, then one of the functions equals the other function plus some constant on that interval. This also follows from the mean value theorem, because if we look at the function f of x minus g of x, let's call that something like h of x, then h prime of x is f prime of x minus g prime of x, which we've said, since f prime and g prime are equal, should be 0. Well then, if the derivative is 0, then f of x minus g of x, the original function, has to be a constant. So if you have two functions with the same derivative, they can only differ by a constant. This tells us that the family of all antiderivatives, is one antiderivative plus a constant. They all are the same except for a constant. So what do I mean by this? I mean that if we're looking for the antiderivative of x squared, then we said a particular antiderivative was x cubed over 3, but we can get a family of antiderivatives, also called a general antiderivative, by adding a constant. What this means is that all functions of the form x cubed divided by 3 plus c have the derivative x squared, and there are no other functions that are not of this form that have the derivative x squared. So we'd like to have some rules for antiderivatives. We've just talked about the antiderivative of 2x being x squared, and the antiderivative of x squared being x cubed over 3. These little arrows, they don't make much sense. So how do you write antiderivative? Well, writing antiderivative has a strange notation. You write a squiggly line, it's a big long S. It's called an integral sign. and then you leave a space, and then you put a dx at the end. So all this together is the notation that means antiderivative. So if you put the function in the middle, like the antiderivative of 2x is x squared. Or the antiderivative of x squared is x cubed over 3. But both of these, remember, are plus c, because there could be a constant at the end whose derivative is 0. So what can we say about f of x equals x to the n? Well, I know that when I take a derivative, I decrease the power by 1. So when I take the antiderivative, I should increase the power by 1. But this isn't good enough. If I take the derivative of this, I'm going to get n plus 1 times the quantity x to the n. N plus 1 minus 1 is n. But I don't want n plus 1 times x to the n. I just want x to the n. So my original function should actually be x to the n plus 1 divided by n plus 1. Then, in general, when I take the derivative, I get n plus 1 times x to the n, all divided by n plus 1, because of that n plus 1 out front. These cancel, and we just get x to the n. This should make sense, because this is what we just did for x squared. We bumped the power up by 1, and also divided by that number. So what we can say, using our integral notation, is that the integral of x to the n is x to the n plus 1 divided by n plus 1 plus c. Another example of something we'd like to have a formula for is sine of ax. Before we even do that, let's talk about sine of x. What is the antiderivative of sine of x? What function, when you take the derivative, do you get sine of x? Well, you might be thinking cosine of x, but the derivative of cosine of x, remember, is negative sine of x. So if we actually want a particular antiderivative of sine of x, we need to say that it's negative cosine, because negative cosine's derivative would be negative negative sine, giving us back the sine that we want. So a specific antiderivative of sine of x is negative cosine of x, and the general antiderivative is negative cosine of x plus c. But how does that help us with sine of ax? Well, it doesn't exactly. You might think that the antiderivative of sine of ax should then be negative cosine of ax. But let's try that. If we take the derivative of negative cosine of ax, we get sine of ax times a. Now remember that a is coming from the chain rule. The derivative of negative cosine of ax is the outer function is cosine, so it's negative cosine, so its derivative is sine. Keep the inside, and then multiply by the derivative of the inside. So now we have an extra a. Well, what should we do about it? Instead of saying that our antiderivative is negative cosine of ax, we should say that the antiderivative of sine of ax is 1 divided by a times negative cosine of ax plus some constant c. We can check our work by taking the derivative of 1 over a negative cosine of ax plus c. Keep the 1 over a out front. The derivative of negative cosine is sine. Keep the inside ax. Multiply by the derivative of ax because of the chain rule. And then add the derivative of c, which is 0. You can see that this simplifies to our original sine of ax. And in fact, we can generalize this statement to say that the antiderivative of any function of a constant a times x is going to be 1 over a, the antiderivative of the original function f with ax plugged in, plus c. If you have some function f of x whose antiderivative is capital F of x plus c, then the antiderivative of f of ax for some number a times x, this is a number here, no x is in it, some number a times x is 1 over a f of ax plus c. This is undoing the chain rule that's involved in this ax. In this example, it gives us this function, g prime of x equals 4 sine of x plus 2 x to the fifth minus the square root of x divided by x. But it gives us more information than that. It tells us an actual point on the curve g of x. By knowing this point, we can find a single function which is both an antiderivative of g prime and has this one point on the curve. Because, as we said, the family of antiderivatives is all the same function plus c. If we go back here and we look at some of these pictures, they all look exactly the same, except they're shifted up and down. Remember, adding a constant shifts it up and down. So if I tell you that this point is on the curve, then that guarantees that this is the curve that I'm on. And what's more, if I tell you this point's on the curve, even though there's no curve here, I know it's going to look just like all these other curves, only go through that point. So for any antiderivative problem, if they give you both the derivative and a point on the original function, you can find the specific function that satisfies both these conditions. This is called an initial value problem. And the point on the curve, here g of 0 equals 6, is called an initial condition. Let's see if we can solve this problem. I look at this g prime of x and I want to find its antiderivative. I want the antiderivative of 4 sine of x plus 2x to the fifth minus square root of x divided by x. Now, just like derivatives, antiderivatives can be split across sums and constants can be pulled out front. Because just like sums and constants don't affect derivatives, they also don't affect antiderivatives. This should make some sense. So let's split this antiderivative up across this middle sum. So now we're saying we're looking at the antiderivative of 4 sine of x. Remember, this dx is part of the antiderivative, or what's also called the indefinite integral notation, plus the antiderivative of 2x to the fifth minus square root of x divided by x dx. Now we can do each of these antiderivatives separately. For the antiderivative of 4 sine of x dx, we can pull the 4 out front because it's a constant. And then we know that the antiderivative of sine of x is negative cosine. So we get negative 4 cosine of x plus c for the antiderivative of sine of x. Now we also have to find the antiderivative of 2x to the fifth minus the square root of x divided by x. Now this is difficult to find in this form, so we're going to simplify algebraically. We're going to say that this is the same as the antiderivative of 2x to the fifth divided by x minus the square root of x divided by x, which is the same as 2x to the fourth minus, recall that this is x to the 1/2, and this is x to the negative 1. So combining these exponents, we get x to the negative 1/2. And now, again, we can split this antiderivative into two antiderivatives. So we have the antiderivative of 2x to the 4th dx minus the antiderivative of x to the negative 1/2 dx. For the antiderivative of 2x to the 4th dx, we can pull out the 2. So we're looking at the antiderivative of x to the 4th dx minus and then the antiderivative of x to the negative 1/2 dx. Well, both of these will use the antiderivative of x to the n rule that we just worked on. So we will get 2 x to the 5th over 5, bumping up the power by 1 and then dividing by that number, plus a constant c, minus, if you increase negative 1/2 by 1, you get 1/2. So x to the 1/2 divided by 1/2 plus c. And remember, we had from before negative 4 cosine of x plus c. Now, all of these c's, these constants, they all say c, but we don't really know they're the same constant. So we should really call them c1, c2, and c3. You could have different constants at each step. But also notice that if we go to simplify, we get negative 4 cosine of x plus 2/5 x to the 5th minus 2 x to the 1/2 plus c1 plus c2 minus c3. Well, what can you say about c1 plus c2 minus c3? Well, we don't know anything about any of these numbers except that they're constants, but we do know that if we add them together, we're also going to get a constant. So instead of writing an individual constant with each term in an antiderivative, we usually just write one big constant c at the end. So we're going to say that we know that the general form for g of x is negative 4 cosine of x plus 2/5 x to the 5th minus 2 x to the 1/2 plus some constant c. Now this is the general solution. It's the antiderivative. But we now want a specific solution with the fact that g of 0 equals 6. So we can get this by plugging 0 into the original function. So we get negative 4 cosine of 0 plus 2/5 times 0 to the 5th minus 2 0 to the 1/2 plus c, and we know that that has to equal 6. So, well, cosine of 0 is 1, so we get negative 4 plus 0 minus 0 plus c equals 6, which says that negative 4 plus c equals 6, or c equals 10. That tells us that our original function g of x was actually negative 4 cosine of x plus 2/5 x to the 5th minus 2 x to the 1/2 plus 10. Let's try this one more time. If we know that f prime is e to the x plus 20, 1 plus x squared, and that f of 0 is negative 2, can we find one specific function for the original function f? We have that we're looking for the antiderivative of e to the x plus, I'm going to go ahead and distribute this right away, 20 plus 20x squared, and you see that we can split this up across these addition signs. So we get the antiderivative of e to the x plus the antiderivative of 20 plus the antiderivative of 20x squared dx. Well, the antiderivative of e to the x, the derivative of e to the x is itself, so it's also its own antiderivative. So we have e to the x there, plus the antiderivative of constant is that constant times x, because the derivative of 20x would be 20, plus we bring that constant 20 along for a ride, pulling it out front, and the antiderivative of x squared is x cubed over 3. Now we found all of these antiderivatives, and we add one big plus c to the end. This is our antiderivative. This is a general form of f of x. But now we know a specific point on f of x. We know that f of 0 is equal to negative 2. So that means e to the 0 plus 20 times 0 plus 20 times 0 cubed plus 3 plus c equals negative 2, which means 1 plus 0 plus 0 plus c equals negative 2, which means that c equals negative 3. So we can say that our original function f had to be e to the x plus 20x plus 20 x cubed over 3 minus 3. So this is our original function. And you can feel free to check this by finding f prime and by finding f of 0.